in the Middle East, you have a, basically a similar situation. You don't want the preponderance of power to shift either one way or the other in order to, for military victory to be inflicted on the opponent at the cost of certain accepted positions. Now in the subcontinent, unfortunately, temporarily, that military balance of power has shifted by the recent events. I don't think that it's in the interest of some of the great powers to allow that to happen for all times.
Mr. President.
President, there's a question here. You talked about this awful bashing, a hell of a bashing, but we'd like to know the bashing that we journalists have received for the last 12 years from the Ministry of Information. What are you going to do about that? Are you going to protect the freedom of the press because you talked about democracy?
Can I know your name?
I'm Anish Mehta.
You used to write so much in favor of me when I was against me when I was not a foreign minister. That shows that freedom of the press.
I'm nobody, Mr. President. I belong to the people of Pakistan.
We went to school together.
Well, there's a principle involved. Principle involved is that he's been elected by the people in the last election. That's the I'm going by the principle, and I don't see why that should be provocative if I come out with certain other statements after I have consulted the people, after I've got the approval of the people, because I go to the people with for approval on certain very hard decisions, on certain very unpopular decisions, because the people have been misled. So I must first go and clear the cobwebs, and after I've done that, I'm prepared to take the subsequent steps. That should not take too long.
Mr. President, is it possible for you to foresee any contact with East Pakistani leaders?
I know.
At the present moment.
Sooner the better.
How can you contact them?
I have better means than you.
No,
direct.
President, you haven't answered my question. You made a very flattering statement, but I'm not one of those women to be flattered.
I know that also.
You have to give us a commitment on the freedom of the press. There are many journalists here who have suffered.
I've already taken the first step. I told you that I'm going to take some action regarding the press trust. And as much as you have suffered, we have suffered. I think we have suffered more than you have suffered. The calumny that has been thrust, that has been hurled against us, the abuses, the slander. But we intend to take all these steps, and I've said that we have already taken action that the managing director of the press trust should be removed straight away, and the editor of Pakistan Times, to satisfy you, should also be removed straight away, Mr. Sulaiman.
Very good.
Certainly, the power of
there was a proclamation by the president, and there was a correct to the proclamation, an oath of office taken by me. Because the proclamation came by virtue of being the chief marshal or administrator.
Mr. President, what will be your practical approach to India in the next coming days?
I told you it depends a great deal on India's attitude as well. If India thinks that she has secured magnificent military victories and now she can dictate her terms to Pakistan, then she is sadly mistaken. India has two options open to her. One is to come to honorable and just equitable terms with Pakistan and live in the same subcontinent on the basis of the Pakistan that was established in 1947. Or else India must feel that she can impose a will on Pakistan. If she does that, then I'm afraid it's going to be a house-to-house fight, impeccable, imperishable hostility between the two peoples. We've had enough of it. We want to put an end to it to serve the poor people of Pakistan, and there's poverty in India as well. But it depends on India's attitude, and it doesn't depend alone on our attitude, because we will not submit. You see, there are two alternatives open to us also. Either to accept defeat or to muster defiance. I would never accept defeat. Then it should be defiance. If India wants to prevent defiance, then there's a third method, open neither to India nor to us, to lay down arms honorably and to serve the poor people of India and to serve the poor people of Pakistan, live and let live, like Sweden and Sweden and Norway are living, like Germany and France are living, like many other former opponents are living in the same region of the world. It's now left to them. We will take political initiatives to see in which direction they want to go. We have two alternatives. They have two alternatives. Are we going to remove our alternatives? Are they going to remove their alternatives and take the real course? And in that, all of you can cooperate.
Sir, what do you call honorable and just?
Well, Pakistan as it existed in 1947 and the settlement of Jammu and Kashmir dispute.
Mr. President, as a logical man, I know you are, you will not accept the loss of East Pakistan as a fair conflict.
Realities are temporary phenomena. Realities change. I can assure you that soon you will find the Pakistan sentiment in East Pakistan blossoming, because you will see what's already I am getting reports which do not surprise me but only confirm my own thoughts. Okay, two more questions.
Mr. President, do you anticipate anything like resuming relationship with India?
That depends on India as well. I've answered that question. If they want to live properly, sensibly, on the basis of the understanding of 1947, Pakistan and India, and the settlement of the Jammu and Kashmir dispute, certainly, why not? We live together. We can't carve ourselves out of the subcontinent and go somewhere else.
Yeah, when you will talk to them, that's to say, either a summit meeting or diplomatic relations or something else. What is it going to be?
We'll work on it. We're working on it. Already we're working on it.
So my some people have noticed that you didn't mention anything about Kashmir in your broadcast.
You see, the question is that if India wants to impose the will of people of East Pakistan by her own interpretation through military force, certainly she has a right to be asked the question. Now, what about the promise you made to the people of Jammu and Kashmir? But, my dear friend, first things first. First thing we have to do is to vacate aggression of our territory in East Pakistan. Because unless the Indian occupation is vacated, we really cannot talk in an atmosphere of freedom and without foreign interference with our brothers in East Pakistan. And Kashmir has remained a disputed territory. Bengal, Muslim Bengal, our Bengal, our Sonar Bangala has never been a part of India. And India wants to take our golden Bengal. She wants the economic benefits of our golden Bengal. Golden Bengal belongs to Pakistan. Not because I say so, because the people of golden Bengal wanted to be a part of Pakistan.
How are you going to get the Indians out of golden Bengal, sir?
World opinion, great powers, India's own interest, because she'd see that her remaining in golden Bengal is a diminishing return by the moment. Today only they tried to hoist the Indian flag on the government house and it was burnt down. Isn't that? And things are happening. There'll be trouble between the Mukti Bahini and the Indians. There'll be trouble between the leftists, rightists, all sorts of factors. You know, I shudder to think as to what the future of that unfortunate province or that unfortunate land of ours will be. Bengal, both Golden Bengal and Bangladesh of India, East and West, have both suffered so much. If you go right back into the history, right from 1712, it's been a tragic history. And a new leaf must be turned. It must be turned soon. The spiral of revenge must not go up and up. Tension must not be added to tension. Somewhere someone with vision, somewhere someone with sense of humanism must say, we cut the Gordian knot. And this is what's going to happen to Bengal. The streets of Calcutta are full of people who are sleeping there on the road. So there's no picture of hope for my Bengal, for golden Bengal to be a part of India. The India's Bengal
is not California, India's Bengal is not San Francisco or United States, where you say, let's go to the promised land. That's not the promised land, that's the slum of the world. My Bengal will not go to the slum of the world. But we have been victims of mistakes. But the victims of mistakes does not mean that we must be dismembered.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.